Thank you, Mike. Thank you. So does anybody have any questions, not only just for me, but also for Sharon, starting from this morning or other sessions where I haven't been? We'll start out if anybody has questions. Justin, you have a mic?
I do.
Live mic? Okay, good. There's a question back there.
I looked in a book on Heart Sutra, and it uses the term victor rather than Buddha. What's the meaning of that?
He said he looked at a translation of the Heart Sutra.
Yeah.
And it used the word victor rather than Buddha. So what is the meaning of that?
Yeah, well, one of the names of Buddha is Jinna. And I'm glad they use victor. Some people use conqueror, which I don't really like, but it means conqueror of ignorance. And in some cases, and I think at one or two spots in the sutra, maybe they do use victor, in the original, Gyalwa, you know. But mostly they use Buddha. I don't know why they put in victor. Most of the mentions of Shakyamuni in the Heart Sutra. Was it from Chinese, or was it from
the book?
Tibetan?
The Heart Sutra book, sorry. The Heart Sutra book in the library.
I see. Well, there are some, they used it all the way through, victor, in every case. Mm-hmm. Then that's wrong, because the original says Buddha. In other words, it's a name of Buddha, so it's okay. If you try, you can translate either victor or conqueror. The word is Jinna, like in Mahavira, Jinna, you know. Most of the expressions in the Heart Sutra are Buddha. Anyway, that's a good question. Any other question? Yes, she has a question. Oh. Thank you, Justin.
Thank you. This is for both of you. Sharon, I think that you had talked about the translation of the word meditation from Pali being cultivation. And I've also heard it said that it's familiarity. So can you clarify that a little bit?
The question was about, I said that the translation from the Pali for the word we call meditation, the translation is actually cultivation.
Yeah, ubhavana.
Ubhavana. Uh-huh. And that she's also heard that it can mean sometimes in Tibetan traditions, it's called familiarity or get familiar with.
Yeah, but that's. Oh, you are.
No. So yeah, I can talk about cultivation, but I think the question was about. I know Dzogchen teachers call it get familiar with.
They're just trying to be sexy and friendly. let's be friends with it all. That's kind of thing. It's, there is a word in Tibetan that is spelled differently, which almost like gomba, which is komba, which means to familiarize, to habituate or familiarize. Actually, the Sanskrit word bhavana comes from the root, from the verb bhu, B-H-U, which means to be, actually. So bhavana means to bring into being. So in a way, the best meaning for it would be realization. And actually, an English word, meditation, like the meditations of Descartes and so on, has a tendency to be a kind of systematic thinking in English, really. And so ideally, the word, which everyone translates as meditation all the time, there should be realization, I think, for bhavana, because the idea of bhavana is that you learn something, and you really deeply learn it, and you have it in your memory. Then you critically meditate on it in the sense of think it all over from all angles and all sides and doubt whether it's this way or it's that way or whatever it is. And then when your doubt gets to a point where you're still probing, but you're not being so discursive, and you're unifying that thinking about it into like a single point, then that's when you realize the thing. In other words, make it real. You know what I mean? What you were saying, cultivation, which is fine. You cultivate the understanding, but you come to the understanding through the critical thinking. But then that understanding often, especially because of the main fact that the Buddha's challenge to us is that what we think and what we see has a mistaken element in it. We perceive things wrongly, in other words. We see things as if they had intrinsic reality, essential existence. We experience ourselves as having essential existence. And this is wrong. But it doesn't help us necessarily just to think it's wrong. What it is we have to fully examine it, to accept the challenge to examine it. And then when it won't withstand analysis, we get liberated a little bit from the wrong feeling. So therefore, for example, to understand emptiness, you can critically understand as a thought experiment, which would be the, in a way, almost like meditation, you know, like Descartes' meditation. As a thought experiment, you can realize that you will not be able to pinpoint your own nose, right? In other words, your nose, when you really investigate it, it has loose boundaries. It's kind of like, well, I'll call this from here the nose, you know. And, you know, every point on the nose, every atom in the nose dissolves under analysis. So that your nose cannot kind of be verified as having intrinsic existence, coming out of its own essence, you follow me? It's just a relational, conventional existence. But it exists, but it's not like as real as it seems to be, put it that way, right? But when you realize that through thought experiment, you still see that the nose seems to be intrinsically there. So that's where bhavana comes in. Bhavana means you bring into being what you've understood discursively, but which has not uprooted your habitual tendency of misperception and misunderstanding. You follow me? The bhavana presses it down and matches the many years and possibly many lifetimes of a wrong habit that we've had of perceiving the world in an unrealistic way. Do you follow me? So it would be a kind of earth-shaking. In the Tibetan, they take the word gomba, which connects sort of in sound to familiarize, but they take that word and they add certain things to it to make it mean like a bringing into reality, you know, to make it again, not just habituate, but bring into reality, if you follow me. Is that clear? Does everyone get that? It's what we lack in our education. You know, like people can be educated that, you know, there's no genetic difference between blacks and whites and yellows and, or between Jewish and Gentile or between whatever it is, you know. There's no genetic much difference between them, right? Two villages in Africa have more genetic difference than a Brooklyn Jew and a Chinese from Shanghai, actually, even though they kind of look different, you know. But people still have prejudice. They get on a bus in the South, you know, and they look like that, you know. And like, who was it? My friend Liz Fukushima, her grandmother used to say, who was Japanese American, her grandmother used to say that God undercooked the white people. So they were all like a little bit too whitish and pinkish. And he overcooked the black people because they were a little bit dark. But the yellow people are perfectly brown. She used to say, a Christian Japanese American. So, I mean, people still have a gut feeling of prejudice, right? Or male or sexist chauvinism or something like that. Or nationalist chauvinism. They meet a Klingon or a Russian, you know? And they get like, oh, you know, like that. And vice versa. So bhavana is where something you know, which you have learned and is reasonable and makes sense to you, goes in and is pushed against your subconscious or subliminal habit to change even your gut reaction, where you have a correct, you know, instinctive, you change your instinct even like that. Because Buddhist notion of the plasticity of the human being is so huge that the goal of enlightenment is not just to change your conscious thought, but to change your total autonomic nervous system, actually. Like a Buddha could pass a witch's test, a real Buddha. If a Buddha was held underwater, he could simply not breathe and wouldn't die. Actually, which is a little more than passing. That's like getting A+. But you know, he could, the involuntary response to breathe is not involuntarily experienced by an enlightened being, even physical level, but also subconscious. There's no subconscious left. All levels of everything is aware of everything is the idea. Okay? So bhavana, really, we should have meditate and realize. What are you doing? I'm realizing, you know? But it's kind of stuck at meditating at the moment. Maybe in a generation or two, things like that. Well, that there basically, there's dhyana, bhavana, there's chinta, there's various varieties of that. There's like five or six words for meditating, actually, in Sanskrit and Pali, that we don't really have different words for. Yeah, follow up? Sure.
Yeah, so Sharon, the question part?
Yeah, I mean, that's a common translation. So Bob is approving, but saying there could be a better one from his point of view.
Yeah, because it comes from the verb to be, basically. It means make something,
to make something
exist.
Being, to
bring into being something.
Thank you.
Bhavana. Yes, here's another question. Okay, there's one.
Thank you. Another question from a beginner point of view. I wanted to ask, in the traditions, in the places where Buddhist tradition is present, is a newborn born enlightened and then corrupted by growing up and therefore needs to be brought back? Or is it step zero of the enlightenment and has to be cultivated accordingly? And if so, how's the educational system shaped to facilitate this?
I heard the question. Yeah, you would answer.
I wouldn't say anywhere have I encountered a belief that a being is born enlightened. You know, I mean, perhaps in some rarefied bodhisattva sense, but I don't know. In Burma, they wouldn't necessarily call that enlightened in the sense of a Buddha, because the idea, if you're talking about a traditional Buddhist culture, a place like Burma, there is a very strong belief in past and future lives, you know, and so that infant is not born kind of as a blank, pure,
right,
unaffected being. They're trailing this infinite store of previous lives. And so I would say no, not that I've encountered, you know. I mean, Bob can answer maybe in terms of some Tibetan circles in terms of a bodhisattva, but and the education system, I think, it's very variable. I think to some extent there can be, and it's wonderful when there is a kind of conviction that we all have the potential, the aptitude for realization, for understanding, for freedom. And that's a very different kind of basic fundamental belief than you're wretched, you know, or you're bad. But I mean, systems are systems. There are a lot of systems of education that are very harsh from our point of view, you know, from a Western point of view. Some that are not. And I do think that there is a kind of potentially liberating quality of that core belief, you know, that really fundamental sense of what you will find if you go underneath the habits and patterns of an ordinary day. You know, when you make a mistake, you know, underneath that, is there the potential for change and growth and enlightenment, or is there just this forsaken state, you know, where we're all bad? I do think that makes a difference, but not maybe exactly as you're describing it.
Actually, the body of emanation of a Buddha, in a way, when an emanation body is born, there are two kinds. And one kind is born Buddha's emanation body can be born with the enlightened knowledge already, but mostly to emanate into, the reason of an emanation is to join the living beings in order to help them. And so then Buddha will emanate as a being that has forgotten it was enlightened. So then they have to relearn how to be enlightened. And in the legend of Buddha's birth, which Westerners would call a legend, where he speaks at birth and says, I'm the best thing on 2 feet, which is in Pali tradition also. In that legend, he then shuts up and acts like a regular baby. And then he's like Siddhartha, and he has to learn, and he has to remember, and he goes through like being a human. So there's the same kind of play. They have the same issue in Christianity, whether Christ is just a sort of a play of God's, that he's pretending to suffer, pretending to be a human being, but he's really just God, or whether Christ is a human who really feels forsaken and suffers, etc. So God, in other words, emanates as a being that doesn't know he's God until he dies. You know what I mean? There's two ways of seeing. So Buddha has the same. In Buddhism, there's a similar thing in Mahayana Buddhism. When they get into elaborating more the idea of an emanation body, or really what they say in the debates between some Theravada and Mahasanghika, what we call Nikaya Buddhism, the monastic dualistic Buddhism, which are 8 sects, of which I think were Theravada, 10 were Mahasanghika. In those debates, there's a big question about what's the difference between Buddha, who is a Buddha arhat, and the regular arhat. How come Buddha is such an effective teacher and has so much a bigger knowledge about the nature and the reality and everything than the arhat, when both have attained nirvana? And the difference between those two then gets elaborated in the Mahayana, you know, and all these things of the three bodies of the Buddha and all of that. You know. But it's sort of there, it's left there, like, you know, like for example, Buddha has 500 previous lives as a bodhisattva, where he gives his body and he does all kinds of things. In the original Walt Disney stories, right, the Jataka tales, have you ever run into those? They're very important to read, actually, if you can encounter them in some publications, where Buddha was a deer and he was a monkey and he was a this and a that, and different kinds of human beings. He was a woman in many lives. And they never discussed the arhat was such and such, you know, like Shariputra was many, many different things. Much. Sometimes Buddha says, oh, in that life, Shariputra, you were the tigress, and you were this and that, but they themselves don't, he never says to them, all of you have to go through all of this kind of lives in order to get to be a Buddha like myself, to be able to found a Sangha like I'm doing, you know, which you wouldn't be able to do without me. So they leave that difference unaddressed, if you will, in the dualistic thing. And everything gets torn to shreds in the Maya. Sorry, there was another question. Someone had, yes.
I have a meditation question. Sharon, I think a few days ago you might have mentioned that you recently wrote something about dealing with strong emotion that comes up during meditation. Maybe you didn't say that, but I was wondering if you could say anything about maybe like maintaining that equanimity in the face of overwhelming emotion that can come up.
Hello. The first thing I would say was I always hesitate about the use of the word maintaining, which I use, of course, as well, because it's so conventional a way of describing things, and people often ask at the end of a retreat, for example, how can I maintain the level of mindfulness that I experienced here? Or how can I stay mindful all day long at work? Or how can I keep this degree of concentration? And my response is usually, you won't, because nothing is static, and more the skill is returning. You know, it really is almost a kind of resilience skill. We completely lose it, then we come back. And then maybe we completely lose it, and we come back. And I say that just because there are so many ways we could consider our practice and ourselves a failure that are also misconceptions, that we're actually doing fine, you know, but we think it shouldn't be the way it actually is. So I wouldn't worry if you get overwhelmed by strong emotion. And I wouldn't decree that like the failure, but more seeing it as, okay, I really need to regroup. I need to come back, you know, to what I understand to be a more balanced place. So most of that is the way we use the term mindfulness, which would mean, for example, let's say you're sitting, feeling your breath, kind of minding your own business, and there's this tremendous wave of anger or fear that comes up. First, looking to see perhaps not adding so many things to that moment's experience. And if those things do come up, not believing them so completely. I'm such an angry person, and I always will be. The only one who's ever felt this. This is the only thing I've ever felt. This is unyielding, permanent. It's taken over. Something like that. And so then we're kind of left with the experience without, it's not like the experience plus. So going back to my friend Sylvia's immortal example, you're left with the gefilte fish, not the gefilte fish and the horseradish on top of it. Okay, so let's say it's a state of anger or fear. Like the next suggestion would be, okay, what do you feel in your body? You know, that means that you're not lost in it's right, it's wrong, I'm gonna do this vengeful thing and that vengeful thing and then finally ruin your life that way. You're also not, I can't believe I'm angry, I'm such a hideous person, you know, I've been meditating for like an hour and a half, you know, and I'm still angry, I'm like the worst. It's just like, okay, there's anger. What does it feel like? And then we feel the different sensations that are that state. We also get the chance to kind of watch the anger movie. It's not what provoked this and how can I stop it, but what is this? What is this? Like, one of my teachers, this man named Menindra, was visiting in Barry at the Insight Meditation Society, and I was sitting, and he was teaching, and so if that was IMS and he was there, maybe I'd been meditating for 6 years or something like that at that point, and I must have felt like a big wave of anger, and I was very distressed about it. You know, it was kind of like, I've been meditating for 6 years, it's long enough, shouldn't be here. And I must have revealed that in the tone of voice in which I was describing my experience, because he said, this is how you should be with your anger. Imagine a spaceship has landed on the front lawn, and these Martians come out, and they come up to you, and they say, what is anger? What is anger? What is it? So we take a look at it. What is this state? And that's when we see it's a compound. Moments of fear, moments of grief maybe, moments of helplessness, moments of rage, moments of sadness, you know, and so not only do we see the different strands that make up what we call this experience of anger, we also see they're constantly changing. That's not like an alive system. It's moving, right? It's not the static thing that has taken over we're going to feel forever. So we've now gone from the arising of anger to a powerful insight about the nature of change, which is really like the nature of life. So that's one of the reasons they say that mindfulness is not about what's happening, it's about how you're relating to what's happening. And you can have that same kind of profound insight into, say, the nature of change, the nature of contingency, you know, things being connected and so on, looking at bliss and looking at anger. So, like any reasonable human being, you know, I would say if someone stopped me on my way into this room and said, would you rather have a profound insight into change, looking at bliss or looking at anger? I'd say bliss. But since no one gives us a menu thus far, it can be a very useful and important experience to have a really difficult emotion arise. You know, so some of it is stage-wise, or it's, you know, a progression like that. An awful lot of it is noticing what we tend to add on. I'm bad, I'm wrong, I should never feel this kind of thing, you know, whatever. It might be because that just doesn't help.
Here's a question.
Thank you. I don't know really how to phrase the question, but I have two adolescents at home who are far away from taking any meditation class. But if I came home and told them, well, they know, but I just took a 3-day of teaching on the art of happiness. How could I define what is happiness for them? Because just saying it's the lack of suffering is not going to cut it, you know? And they're going through huge emotions. So how can I give them a definition of happiness at that age?
Well, I'm going to turn it over to you since you're a dad.
Okay,
I think we'll start with you.
Yes, well. Happiness. They say that contentment is the most precious jewel. That they have a, there's a kind of a Asian mythic thing that there's a naga, which is like this snake, serpent, or dragon type of being, mythical being, that has 9 heads and has a precious jewel in the head of every, in every head, has like a crown jewel, like a big diamond or ruby or something. And they say that every one of the jewels is a worry to the naga, but the most precious, more precious than all the jewels in the head of the nagas, is contentment. That is being happy with whatever is there, being content with, you know, like counting blessings sort of thing. I think what they're looking for there is a kind of natural happiness that we find when we are temporarily not looking for something to make us happy. That's not coming from a, therefore, from a circumstantial situation. In other words, it's not because we just won something or got something or did something. It's not that kind of happiness that's dependent on some kind of context. But it's like a happiness that wells up, a natural feeling of well-being from within. And which is what contentment sort of is, you know. And when Shantideva says, for example, that, what Dalai Lama says, he says, if you want to be happy, be compassionate, he says. And then if you want to make someone else happy, be compassionate. If you want to be happy yourself, be compassionate. If you want to be selfish, in the sense of want to be happy yourself, the best thing is to make someone else happy. That's what's called being a wise selfish. He has a kind of bunch of slogans like that. Then Shantideva, he says, all happiness in this world comes from the wish for others' happiness. And all unhappiness in this world, suffering in this world, comes from the wish for one's own happiness, which is kind of a real shocking statement that he makes there. And this leads to what I call the Shantideva challenge, where one analyzes when one is happy, what is it that makes you happy when you're happy? For example, when you're happy, what makes you particularly happy yourself? Think about it. Maybe let's just do something simple, like some music that you really love and you listen to in an undisturbed setting. And for a moment, you just with the music. And you're not thinking about how happy I am that I'm listening to this music at all. And you're just carried with the music. And then when it ends then the music ends, maybe, right? And or even before it's ended, it might end, the happiness part might end while it's still playing, but you might think, how much do I really like this music? Was it really the best time I've heard this music? Was it better if I would hear it live in the concert? Was it any moment you stop to evaluate your experience of the music will cut off the happiness? So that kind of means that when you're forgetting that you want, that you need some more thing to be happy, that moment of forgetting, then it brings a kind of happiness, right? Can you analyze it? If you think of different kinds of aesthetic experiences, that's the case. Also, sometimes maybe you're not feeling that well. You mentioned you had two little something at home with these children.
I was going to say, she wonders about
children,
teenagers.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
How would you say this to a teenager?
Oh, yeah. So this is very good for them, yeah. So the thing is that sometimes you're not feeling that great yourself. You have something bothering you a little bit. But one of your teenagers is having some kind of issue, and somehow you come up with just a really great thing for them. You're very focused on getting them to feel better. And you come up with something really good, and then you see they feel better. And then you feel quite happy. And you forget that some other things are bothering you. So again, that's the idea that you're focused on the other's happiness. So there's an element when you focus on another happiness where you don't think about how happy you are for that moment or some longer period of time. And that in itself gives you some relief. Because whenever we think about how happy are we're almost always discontented with whatever it is, because we could be more happy.
So Bob, how would you say that to a teenager?
Well, no. The way you would, I think that what you would do is you would say, well, in that 3-day retreat, I was learning something about the process that I am in when I actually feel happy. And I began to realize that it's when I'm not wishing to be more happy from wanting something else that I don't have. And also when I'm not just thinking about myself. And I'm not just thinking like, what more could I have? What am I getting out of it? What more can I? Shall I call somebody? Shall I text somebody? Did I get a date? Did they smile at me yesterday? Whatever it is, I'm not dependent on some sort of results in some other way, and I'm kind of forgetting about that quality. So I think especially for young people who are deluged by images of themselves, commercials, like they probably watch media unless you have a very disciplined household. They probably are involved in their iPhones, etc.
Yes, of course.
They're seeking all kinds of things. They're uncertain about what it is. And certainly, one of the main things that probably interferes with their happiness is you.
They will confirm that.
As a parent.
Blink.
So one thing, you know, so you, I think that you can't really sell happiness to somebody who's, you know, sort of looks at you like, well, you know, I was happy when you were away from here, right?
Yeah, no.
Because then I could call all my friends or do whatever I wanted. And rather, it's a matter of getting them to inquire into what it does that actually, when they feel satisfied, what is it that makes them feel satisfied?
But I liked your example when, you know, when the music, because I think that when they're in their zone, when, you know, one loves drawing, so when he loses himself in his own drawing and the other one in his guitar, it's those moments that are unfiltered, not unconscious.
Yeah, when they hit the zone, that's
when
right.
They're in the
that
zone.
Means they're they're not for the moment thinking,
yeah,
I've got to win this race or something. They're just running, right?
For the pleasure.
Everyone is sort of in the flow. There's all these expressions, you know, Chikshent Mehelye. This name is impossible to pronounce. Famous thing about the zone, you know. Wow. So you could refer to something that they know like that, or specifically about their behavior when you're really kind of gone into whatever it is. It's because your self-involvement, your self-preoccupation, the most miserable people you know, if you think about it, are people who are always thinking, am I in the best chair? Do I have the best thing? Are people paying attention to me? Do I have the best clothes? They're always rebooking and booking their sitting place, their things, their clothes, their mood, their temperature, everything. And they're totally miserable all the time, utterly dissatisfied. And it's the real source of it is what they call self-cherishing or self-preoccupation, self-concern. You know? But self-preoccupation is a better word to use, because when you say self-cherishing, they say atmasneha. In a way, self-love, you could, atmasneha, you could put in Sanskrit or Pali, atmasneha. It would be, I don't know what they say in Pali, but it's very similar to Sanskrit. And because in a way, it's this paradoxical thing. If you really love yourself, meaning want yourself to be happy, then you'll stop loving yourself and you'll love others. In other words, but life is like that, isn't it? You know, and you have to find many ways to explain that to your teenagers. And you might make them laugh when you say, well, I guess you are, one of the great happinesses for you this weekend was I wasn't here to tell you what to do. Teenagers are great, you know, in our country. You know, they're very suppressed in most cultures. But they do get into their thing, and that's very, very important to help them, support them to do that. So happiness, you know, that of course, to go to the extent where reality, and another thing, you know, everyone again so upset when I read long passage, but, you know, you can. They must have seen Star Wars already 2 times, your teenagers. Did you take them to the new Star Wars? 1 time. Well, you can take them back again. But that's a great moment in that Star Wars where that little lady with the funny eyes and the weird glasses speaks to the young woman who is very much an heir of the four of the Jedi. You know, obviously, we don't know yet who. Everybody's speculating. Did you see it?
No.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Anyway.
But I won't remember what you just said, okay, so that's okay.
Anyway, but yeah, well, it's just where she says to her that, you know, you can feel the force in you, all around you. You know, it's so beautiful, you know, something like this. It's like that reality itself is made of happiness. Like happiness is the default condition of the sensitive being. This is a wonderful thing to wrap. This is what our culture absolutely lacks, right? Calvinism, you're thrown out, some weirdo Swiss god threw you out somewhere, and then some of them he creates to make them, they can go in the nice place, and some are doomed ahead of time, no matter what they do. I mean, that is so strange, and the doom is huge, huge. Everything other than Switzerland, more or less. And Geneva. And we're taught that it's very frightening reality. It's bad. It's all bad stuff all around. That's our culture is like that. Because of a need to use fear to discipline unruly people, the authoritarian cultures of the West are like that. And the Buddhist-infused cultures are a bit less like that. They do have that, but they're less like that. And so somehow one way they say, well, Mom, you're over there being happy. Were you really happy or something? Well, maybe one of the best answers would be quietly smile. Then that would get them wondering. The smile. What is she up to? Not trying to explain anything. But self-preoccupation, that's Shantideva's great thing about, actually, we'll meditate on that. We will meditate on that. You want to meditate on that? Should we pause in the question? Okay, let's do that.
Well, there are many more questions.
Oh.
Okay,
we'll come back to questions. Let's just meditate for a minute. Okay. Just a brief meditation. Oh, don't you want to meditate?
Yes.
You don't like meditating?
Yes.
You don't want to realize? What? Okay. So we're going to do 2 meditations, actually. I'll sneak in a second one. Okay. So, what is that?
Something happened with your...
I didn't do much. Just set up.
Was it there?
Oh.
Oh, you're faultless.
It's all right. Okay, so now meditate. Okay, go into yourself. Now, this connects to 2 of the discussions of 2 of the questions. Okay. So now you're meditating. And you already meditated today, I'm sure, earlier. So you're calm. And now turn your attention into yourself. But now in the case of remember something, seek back in your memories for a time when you were falsely accused by someone of something. Like, why did you make that microphone go bang? And you are actually innocent in this particular case that you can remember. You didn't do it. Try to remember such a circumstance. Shouldn't be usually, it can be over a small thing, but better over a bigger thing. When someone accused you, you did something to my something or whatever, and you didn't do it. And you were hurt, if it was someone you care about who is accusing you, you care about what they think of you, and you care about the fact that you're innocent, and you have a very strong feeling of righteousness and injured innocence also, both hurt feelings and also a feeling of innocent purity, injured innocence, let's call it. See if you can remember that. Maybe you could also remember a time when you were angry, when it came up from nowhere in a meditation, or when on the way to being angry, you were righteously indignant and protesting your innocence against a disbelieving accuser. And you were reciting your alibis vociferously. And then you became angry that they insisted still that they didn't believe your protestation of innocence. So all of this complex of emotions, the most crucial one is the one, first one of the injured innocent emotion. If you can find that in your memory or something close to it. I didn't do that. I would never do that. How could he think I did that? I would do that. All of those feelings. And when you remember them, try to inhabit how you felt in the memory. And your rememberer, your observer in your mind, try to make that just kind of from behind a screen or something, like an invisible witness. So your main mind occupies the feeling of injured innocence. The injured innocence you can see usually follows a gamut from injured innocence to righteous indignation and to getting hopping mad. It sort of goes on those, I mean, at various stages in that direction. Now, it will take time, which we don't have, really feel strongly that situation that we can remember. But if you've gotten a tiny hint of it already, then what you must note is that the inner thought, I didn't do that, I am innocent of that. I would never do that. How could he think I did that, would do that sort of thing? That the way that you feel yourself to be the innocent one, to be the righteous one, to be the offended one, the way that you feel that is a contact, the strongest contact you can make with the feeling of having, of being a real self, a feeling of having a fixed identity, independent identity. When the Buddha challenges us with his cardinal teaching of selflessness, identitylessness, essencelessness, unreality, and so on, then he is challenging us to look inside, to find the feeling that we feel where we don't actually agree with him, where we feel, I'm really me. I'm innocent, I wouldn't do that. I'm not like that. That's not me. What I am is innocent, pure, right, real, solid, certain, fixed. So that to the degree that you can find in yourself this strong sense of independent identity, unchanging independent identity, then you can understand what the Buddha meant when he said that you are selfless. Because that then, he's challenging us to entertain the idea that that sense of certain self, selfhood, identity, is mistaken. Because when we really look for that, the referent of that feeling of self, we cannot find anything. So now you can look in your body, in a meditative thought experiment, because when you feel I am innocent, the I seems to rise from a solid place in the heart center, in your chest, or maybe in your head, but you look all around in your body, scan what you know of your anatomy, what you know of your atomic structure, what you know of your subatomic structure, your brain, and of course, there's no little mini homunculus. There's no real Bob in here, whatever your name is. You don't really find a little replica of yourself. That's your real self. Going back in your perceptual apparatus and looking for that point of unchanging witness point, which seems to be the thing that's always present when you experience something, is an unchanging witness of the experience that makes you think you are the same person that when you remember whatever you remember. But when you look to find that, what do you look for? Look at your sensations, the feelings. When you think through your body, your anatomy, and don't find a homunculus or a little like core entity that's you, physical entity, but you still feel like a congested feeling in your chest, which is the way you feel when you're angry or when you're falsely accused or when you feel righteous. It's like you have a tightness in the chest, seeming to be wrapped around something, coming from something. But when you look in there, you can't find anything that your energy is wrapped around. So you don't find yourself as a sensation. Then you look in your concept bank, all your words and names, your own name, Bob, Sharon, Nina, Anna, Yael, Cynthia, Justin, whatever your name is, that's a word, it's a concept. There's a Bob-ness, there's a Sharon-ness, there's a Justin-ness. Sort of you recognize yourself in something, but some people call you other names. You have middle names. You may not use your usual name. You may have nicknames. The name is, and a lot of other people have the same name you do. So it couldn't be the name, could not be your essence, your fixed identity. If you look at an image of yourself in the mirror or in a photograph, in a scrapbook, which picture is you? You look so different at different ages. Which one is yourself? There doesn't seem to be one unchanging image that's you, neither word nor image. So then you move to your emotions, your deeper mental functions, your habit of referring to yourself. But when you refer to that, what do you refer to? When you come up to a door visiting someone, they say, who's there? You say, it's me. What does the me hit? Is it your body? Is it your mind? Is it your awareness? When you're feeling neglected or ignored and you feel I this and I that, where is the I? So you eventually get to your subtlest place, which is your consciousness itself. And then immediately you notice that your sense consciousnesses, your five sense consciousnesses, are always changing by relating to their objects. You see something and your eye sense consciousness wraps itself around the visual object, so it changes. When you hear something, your audio consciousness wraps itself around what you hear and changes, because what you hear is always changing. Your smell consciousness, your taste consciousness, and the touch consciousness of your skin, they're always touching different things that change and they change. Then your mental consciousness has images. It aligns with the different sense consciousness often. Like it gets into registering what you're seeing or hearing or smelling or tasting or touching. And then sometimes it has inner images of, you're not actually smelling something, but it remembers smelling sandalwood incense or something. Remember seeing a bright blue wall. So it has memory images. Then you can visualize Medicine Buddha in the sky or the face of your teenager at home, or the face of some other person in the media. So you could have mental images, and then your mental consciousness changes with the mental images. So what is it that your consciousness is conscious of when you say I, that is referred to by the I? Is there an unchanging point in that consciousness that's always the I? When you get here, you're at the deepest place, and you turn and turn and turn around it, and then you can never quite pin it down. Because when you turn to look for it, and you don't find it, you sort of just go in and out of your chest or something, in and out of your brain. You always think it's just the thing that is looking at me, looking for me, is the thing that's the real me. And if you have concentrative prowess, you'll be kind of develop an inner spinning in your center of your consciousness, where you're looking for yourself, 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 to put it crudely in words. But if you do it more powerfully and rapidly, you don't need the words. And you become like a diamond drill, they say. A diamond drill bit drilling on a diamond drill object. And if you have the concentration to stick with that, the whole thing melts down eventually, kind of, and you come into what is called space-like equipoised samadhi. Samadhi meaning sort of very balanced, concentrated, one-pointed mind where everything seems to be space. The subjectivity looking for the objective self, both seem to melt, both the subjective and the objective both seem to sort of dissolve each other. And you are the vast space or something. I have a feeling like that. Even your sense of having a body will disappear if you do it with quite a sustained effort. And then, even then, although in a way you're kind of gone there, you're gate, gate, paragate, parasamgate, but yet there's a kind of momentum of, well, is this space me? Is that the unchanging me, this vast space? But you don't crudely phrase that to yourself in words because you've gone past being this kind of body that uses words. But the momentum of sort of probing whatever it is you're experiencing, testing for it to see if it's valid, if it withstands your analytic concentration. You're drilling down analytic concentration. And what happens is the space itself disappears under analysis also. And then you're back in the differentiated world. But it has a different quality now because you've had it disappear once. So you kind of, the sense of intrinsic reality, solidity, substantiality, essentiality of the things that you perceive, the differentiated things that you perceive, is reduced, is lessened. They begin to have a kind of illusory quality. This is called the dreamlike aftermath samadhi, concentration. And to some extent, when you've had the relief, even in a mental rehearsal, let's say, of the real thing, you've had a relief of kind of having the subject-object quest dissolve when deeply focused upon. And that dissolving is experienced as a release and a relief. And then when the state of relief disappears, some of the relief goes with it, with you, as you're back in your subject-object world of yourself, of self and other, subject-object world. Mm-hmm. That's why it's called dream-like or illusion-like aftermath. Now, to whatever degree you have experienced this, or imagined experiencing it, rehearsed experiencing it, other people look a little different to you, however, right away. Because you've had a certain relief and release experience behind you. And you immediately pick up in their expression a kind of hypnotized looking, sleepwalking focused, deep yearning for something, they're not sure what, and a sense of discomfort and unease. They seem unrelieved to you, usually. So this is then where, to the extent that you found that inner relief, when accepting the challenge of verifying your sense of your own absolute reality, and failed to find it and sustained that failure into a release from the bitter quest. To whatever extent of relief you have experienced, you note that that's just the relief they are seeking. Mm-hmm. And you note that just like you felt, I should not feel stressed, I should not feel unhappy, I should not suffer. They are feeling that same way and they are looking for relief. They may think it will come from owning something, from having some sort of relationship, from possessing some object, from gaining some knowledge, from having some experience, from being some sort of a certain way. They will all have different goals in mind. But you know the underlying quest that they have, just like you do, is I want to be happy. I don't want to suffer. I have a right to be happy. I don't deserve to suffer. They all feel that way, same as you. And yet you found a little relief in your own nature by looking more deeply into it. And you then want them to find that relief. They're not feeling that way. Begins to be as unbearable to you as you're not feeling that way. You begin to feel that their preoccupation with happiness and non-suffering is just as important as your preoccupation with happiness and non-suffering. They begin to approach some kind of equality. So that is the degree of your compassion. That is called the way of generating compassion by equal exchange of self and other, which means exchanging your self preoccupation for other preoccupation. Your self-centered quest of your own happiness for an altruistic quest of happiness for others, freedom from suffering for others. And it's a tricky one because you note that when you don't find, you don't focus on your own happiness because you're focusing on others' happiness, you start to feel happier. And so you don't want to come back and say, oh, now to get more happy myself, I have to focus more on others' happiness. But then that brings the focus back to your happiness, and then you feel less happy. That's okay. Okay. We did two little meditations there, wisdom and compassion. Take a break. Maybe we should take a break, or we do questions, more questions. We have still
we have
half an hour.
Half an hour.
Yeah.
So
okay.
She had the microphone.
Okay, so let's have a question then. Good.
I have a question about loving kindness. Specifically, if you have a loved one who can often be very critical and sometimes mean, is there any way that you can use loving kindness to either change that or change the effect that it has on you?
I think that's for you.
Well, I always hesitate to think about using loving kindness to change someone else. Because remember, there's those four qualities that are kind of part of that package ultimately, and of loving kindness, compassion, sympathetic joy, and equanimity. And equanimity in the Burmese tradition is really talked about as balance that comes from wisdom. And wisdom tells us you don't have that ability, you know, to. And I've often found that very poignant. I've said, I think it would be great, you know, if we were assigned one person, even in a lifetime, where we could just kind of go, poof, your suffering's gone. But it's not the way things are in a world where conditions have to come together for something to change and so on. You certainly can change your relationship to it, without a doubt. And sometimes dynamics do shift, you know, when one person changes. But if you go back, as I often do, to the idea of loving kindness as a freely given gift, it's a practice of generosity. Once there are strings attached or there are expectations attached, it's something else. Either we end up sort of despondent because we feel our loving kindness is not good enough, person didn't get better, person didn't change, or we, just get more irate at the lack of control, the ability to dominate someone else's mental space. There are many ways I think we can be unfair to ourselves, you know, and that's one of them. But of course, you know, things do shift and change. And when one person in a dynamic changes, it's not unknown, of course, for a dynamic to change or for someone to be responded to with even amusement rather than rejection, sometimes something shifts, you know? But the bottom line is it shifts within us, really.
If I could, I'd like to, could I add a little something?
Yeah.
That, how many of you here know what are called the four immeasurables, which Sharon was just referring to? How many of you know what the four immeasurables are?
We've been talking about it in the evenings.
The what?
We've been talking about it in the evenings.
In the evenings? Oh, yeah. Good. But I don't see many hands going up.
That I didn't call it the four immeasurables.
Oh, what do you call them?
I don't know.
Oh. Well, okay. The Buddhist cosmos has when we are the human beings are in what is called the desire realm, the realm of desire, and it has six heavens in it, which are very heavenly heavens. I mean, they're much better than the Trump Tower or something, or any kind of paradise that you can think of. They are very, very intense paradises, very elaborately described in various, in a large literature. And then the topmost of those heavens has a boundary, and between it and the next realm is called the realm of pure matter, or usually people translate the form realm from some Platonic English connotation, actually, from translating Plato, you know. I think the British all read Plato. So it's not really a form realm, it's a material realm, but it's still a material realm, but it's a material realm of without selfish desire, or with very little selfish desire. And this is divided into, and the beings in those, there are 16 heavens in that realm, those realms, and they are divided into 3, 3, 3, and 7 layers, kind of. And the beings in those realms have bodies that, there's no real estate, sort of, in those realms. And the beings have bodies that are, the deities have bodies that are just kind of energy fields, something like that. And there's no longer sexual differentiation in those realms. The beings have male and female elements in their own energy bodies. So they're kind of self-contained, and that's why they don't have desire for another of a sexual type. That's why they're called realms of pure matter. The lower heavens in the desire realm are very, very sexually fulfilling, and frustrating too. Because it's based on desire, that kind of desire. And those four realms are accessed by human yogis in four layers, what are called the four immeasurables, which Sharon has been teaching you about from an experiential point of view. But it's useful to see the layout of it. And the first level, the first zone, which is called the level of immeasurable love, or loving kindness, however you translate Maitri, Metta. The second one is called the level of immeasurable compassion, Karuna. And these are the same in all Buddhist traditions. And the love one is where the beings are completely, in a way, made of the wish for the happiness of the other, of others. They have a loving wish for others. Basically, that's all they're made of, even. Then the next level up, they're encountering others in their awareness, and they can't bear that others suffer. And therefore, they have the will to the freedom from suffering of others. That's the compassion one. Although the love one is maintained in the compassion one, this is very important. It's not that they leave the loving kindness plane and then move to compassion, becoming aware of others' suffering. They bring the love with them. It's just they match it or combine it with feeling that others shouldn't suffer. They add to that. So it's a more powerful, in a way, realm. And then the third one up, which corresponds to the third zone of the realm of pure matter, material realm, is called the immeasurable realm of joy. And there, they bring the love and the compassion with them, and then they find a joy by seeing that others do have some measure of happiness. They rejoice in the happiness, whatever degree of happiness any beings do have, by bringing up into that third plane both the love that wills their happiness and the compassion that is against their suffering. So those come up. And then finally, the fourth zone, which consists of the seven Brahma heavens, and the god Brahma dwells in that top of that zone. It's called the equanimity zone. And in that zone, the love, immeasurable love, immeasurable compassion, immeasurable joy, all come together in immeasurable equanimity. And what equanimity means there is that they equally feel that way toward every being. There's no particularly favored loved one, and there's no particularly hated and feared unloved one. And there's no enemy, and there's no special friend. Everyone is a friend in that sense. It's one way you can sometimes translate it also is impartiality. But equanimity is still best. And there's a very important point there that the great Jesuit translator of Buddhist texts, Etienne Lamotte, met Lama Govinda once in a conference, interreligious conference. And he said, from all his studies of Buddhism, he finally said the superiority of Christianity was that the highest state in the realm of pure form was, he translated equanimity as l'indifférence, indifference, that you didn't care about anything. So the love was left behind, compassion was left behind, even joy was left behind, and then you just, whatever. State of whatever. And Lama Govinda had pointed out to him, and he was very skeptical about it, and then they didn't have time to go into text, which Lama Govinda could have done, that, you know, that the four immeasurables, they're all immeasurable, so they all overlap into each other, ultimately. And especially, the higher you go, the more intense the love, the compassion, and the joy are in the equanimity plane, because equanimity means that you universally feel the same way for all the mother beings, as they call it. So I just thought that would be interesting for you. And those realms, then they say that there's always a danger in all meditations. The Buddhists always say that in those realms, if you achieve them fully, that you will feel so blissed out in those realms. Imagine immeasurable love, loving kindness, immeasurable compassion, immeasurable joy, and then equally going every direction, that you don't want to go back down into any other form. You're in a vast place of like golden, liquid golden jewel energy. And then what would happen would be you would leave your human embodiment. The way that the gods in those realms would get there is that they were yogis in ancient times, and they left their human embodiment, and they became deities of those realms, which is nice, but it's not enlightenment, complete enlightenment. It's just an aspect. And so it's kind of, you get a little bit trapped there. And then beyond that, the very top of it is like the boundary between finitude and infinitude. And then there's four formless realms or immaterial realms, infinite space, infinite consciousness, beyond absolute nothingness, and beyond consciousness and unconsciousness, which are states of extreme quiescence and quietude, but also, which can also be traps, and you can also become a deity of those realms, and also are not enlightenment, according to Buddha. You just become a deity of those realms. But I'll talk more about those at a different time. So this cosmos, which is a different thing than the sort of solar system and the planet and the galaxy, which is all the material realm, this particular, with those huge mental spaces, you could say, emotional and mental spaces, is kind of important to be aware of. Next question. Yeah. Who's got the questions? You got the questions.
Wait, she's the microphone right there.
Oh, there's another one over here. Oh, he's got one. Okay.
Oh, look at that. Two microphones. Who knew? How about her and then you? Okay. Thanks.
All right. So I'm very new to the Buddhism philosophy, like maybe 3 days old. And this is
like you.
pure. This is out of pure curiosity. if there is reincarnation, do we, I've heard this a lot, like we choose the life we come into. And if that is the case, then are we stuck in that life or can we make choices within that life? So if I've chosen the family I'm born into, does it mean that's the family I need to stay in? Or what's the philosophy on making
stay sure? In, what do you mean, during this lifetime?
During this lifetime? Or right. Are the choices only at the time of rebirth, or are the choices continue happening through life? And, you know, I'm just curious what the philosophy says about this.
Does that mean?
I think who knows, really?
Who knows?
You know, so I don't think of it with that language that we mm-hmm. choose the life, mm-hmm. you know, in that way. I know some people frame it that way because rather than just be disgruntled, you know, and resentful and bitter about, you know, the actions of our parents, for example, it's a different way of framing it. You know, so regardless of, I mean, different philosophical systems will say it in different ways. And that is one way it perhaps could be said, although I don't know, in different contexts, you know. So I wouldn't language it that way myself, but I think that's the purpose of languaging it that way, to say, okay, there may be a reason, there's something to be learned, there's something that's workable, but I think your more basic question is not philosophical, it's you've got a family system and you have to hang out with them through a lifetime, right? Because they're your fate in a way, or they're your, you know, lot in life. And I'm just going to go back to the model that I keep coming back to, you know, which is look at your intention to the best of your ability before an action. And withdrawing is also an action. Look at your intention. Look at trying to act as skillfully as you can to sort of mandate a certain kind of behavior as correct. I think we can have things in mind, you know, guidelines, you know, things like respect or whatever, but I don't think it's like that, you know, that, and people ask me that all the time, you know, I have a parent in jail for these horrible things they've done, and, you know, were I to me, and were I to develop loving kindness, do I have to see them? You know, and I don't think so, you know, I think that we develop loving kindness to free our own hearts from the endless resentment and being captured by the actions of others. And there are lots of things to think about in that decision about whether to actually see them or not, you know? And we try to use discernment and understanding it. Maybe you don't see them alone, or maybe you don't see them, or maybe, you know, but we can get very tied up into and maybe it would be easier. Maybe that's one reason we get tied up. It would be easier to be told, you know, here it is. This is what you need to do if you're honoring that right intention. But I don't think it's that way. You know, I think we're left with that kind of struggle, and the struggle is good.
That's a very good advice. But there is a, you know, in Buddhism, you hear that the arhat, for example, enlightened person has no more rebirth, no more birth. That's like a big goal. Duty is done, everything is done, not be reborn again. And what that means is that the unenlightened person is not really capable of choosing their circumstance of incarnation. And that therefore in English, we probably can create words to match words they have in the original languages. There's a difference between rebirth and reincarnation. Someone who is enlightened, who chooses, a bodhisattva, who chooses to be reborn in a certain setting to do something, then they have a voluntary, they are choosing, they're going somewhere to do a job. You know? But the unenlightened person is just drawn by instinctual attraction. I mean, they do, that is sort of the Buddhist let's say, cosmology or biology. I mean, it's actually scientific. It's their version of a scientific biology. And so when they say no more birth, they mean no more unconscious driven birth, rebirth, just drawn by blind passion. And if you read the description of the process of getting conceived, there is a kind of blind attraction to the parents, an Oedipal experience or an Electra experience prior to conception, actually. Very, very intriguing that they had that from thousands of years ago. But then on a human plane, and Sharon's advice, I think, is really very good. And you get those questions, I'm sure, from people who are reading kind of Western works about, you know, like self-help books, like you chose it, and you're working it out, and oh, fate is behind it, and all this kind of thing, and astrology and astronomy, you know, people deal with all that. And that can be good. That can be useful, too. But the Buddhists do have a theory, like a biological theory about that. Then there's one good thing about that biology, though, when dealing with your teenagers. When your teenager is pissed off at the parent, and they say, I didn't ask to be born in this family, then you can say, yes, you did, dear. You chose us. I mean, and you don't get into whether it was blind passion or they were bodhisattvas choosing. You don't know. But you can say that. And similarly, the child, however, when the parent says, you have to be a doctor or a lawyer because I'm a doctor or a lawyer, you have to marry so-and-so because you're of a certain group and blah, 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 you can say, excuse me, you don't own me. You didn't make me. I just, thanks for the genes. Thanks for the food. Thanks for the, you know, the scrambled eggs in breakfast and the Cheerios or whatever it is. But I have my own karma, my own like path to go. There's a third gene, which was my soul gene that came here. And it's been great, but I'll see you around. I'm going to go be an artist or a hippie or whatever. Or I'm going to go have a transgender operation or whatever. So each one has a certain, you know, the biology theory of karma, whatever else about it. And you have to say another point in Buddhist philosophy, and this is philosophy of science, all descriptions of relative processes are considered relative. That is, they're not absolute dogmas. They are best explanation within what certain context, ideally being Buddha's explanation, they should be, but they are not like absolute anything. So it's a matter of using them in a useful way. And that was the very good advice Sharon said. There is a big thing about when a disaster happens to you, which could be in the form of an alcoholic parent or some sort of tyrant or freaked out, or unalcoholic parent for that matter, could be uptight sort of person, where, okay, I'm suffering this mistreatment or this injuries or whatever, this sickness, and this must be something from my previous life that I'm expiating by that. And I'm going to not resent the person. I'm not going to resent the fact. I'm not going to be sick over being sick. I'm just going to be sick. And I'm going to even try to make a virtue of my sick or my injury by saying I'm getting rid of, I'm expiating past things. And then if you're meditating compassion, you can say I'm absorbing the suffering of other beings in my suffering, hopefully drawing it away from them, and doing a compassion practice out of it and so forth. So actually one can use adversity as a positive thing in the path. What they call, the Tibetans call lojong, or mind practice, mind transformation, means recreating the context. So even a bad thing you can turn into something beneficial for your spiritual development. And so that kind of thing is used that way, you know, when you have mm-hmm. a bad, mm-hmm. when you have a difficult family circumstance, for example, that you bemoan or lament. You know. Like I lost an eye when I was 20 in a foolish accident. I was reasonably dashing before that. And it could be considered a terrible disaster. But my guru embarrassed me, my original root guru embarrassed me at some point in training. I think maybe he was present when somebody asked me what happened to your eye or something, and I stammered out something. He said, don't worry about it, he said. He said, just say, I lost one eye, and I gained 1,000 by discovering the Buddha Dharma. He said, just say it. Don't be embarrassed. Just say that, he said to me. And in a way, it's true, because I would have been some stupid American, maybe in the State Department or something, or maybe in the Army making some war or somewhere, if I had kept my trajectory, you know, sort of in the sort of whatever. Whereas this shocked me, gave me a taste of death, actually, taste of that impermanence, and made me realize that life is something important to use in a meaningful way, something like that, right? But there, on the other hand, Nina loves a book called Journey of Souls, written by Michael Newton, which doesn't agree with the Buddhist thing, in that it has a vision of the between state that is sort of like a Platonic academy in the sky, hovering over Los Angeles. We have Deepak Chopra over here on one side, and with Louise Hay on the other side, and Wayne Dyer on the other side, telling you that, you know, and you have a pod of people that you're reborn with, and this life you're male, this life you're female, and you learn different things, and then you get to evaluate your past life, and then pick a next one and do it. Which she likes very much, and I think it's very fun, and could be useful for some people. But it's different from the Tibetan bardo thing, quite different from the Buddhist bardo biological thing. But Michael Newton, anybody who's had a loved one pass away, or you're yourself terminal for some reason, well, we're all terminal, by the way. Everything is terminal. And so you would find some useful thing out of that. I do like that, too, even though it's a different explanation. So there's no one huge dogma, right?
Mm-hmm.
But there is a Buddhist biology, too. Okay. Next question.
This will be the last question, I think, for the
afternoon. Okay, last question. He's been patiently waiting.
Yes, he's been very patient.
Something I've been puzzling about. You know, there are very many Buddhists in the world. I was checking on Google. It's estimated there's 500 million Buddhists.
Actually more, I think. But go ahead, yes.
Precise number is not important for this question.
Yeah.
It leads me to wonder, given all the Buddhists and considering that Buddha himself was ultimately essentially concerned with our suffering and its eradication, and that there are bodhisattvas that are concerned with the eradication of our suffering, if there are these bodhisattvas. And one would imagine there ought to be many of these bodhisattvas.
Absolutely.
So the paradox here, it's where are they?
Where the hell are they?
It's the Fermi question about the aliens. You know, the physicist Fermi. He's reported to have been discussing the aliens and the, you know, the infinite cosmos, and they've got to be out there.
Right.
Well, if they're out there, like, where the hell are they?
I know. I totally agree with you. I have the
same
patience that you do.
Do you mean where are they in the sense that there's too much suffering?
No.
Where are
the bodhisattvas?
Too many idiots.
Why don't we see them?
I don't see them.
But wait. The thing is this. Everybody else in this room, hold on. First of all, you might be a bodhisattva. You don't even know.
I'd be surprised.
Well, that might be it. Don't you get surprises in life? Yeah, I think
so. That'd be a big one.
That's one. And then two, you can't tell everybody else in this entire room could be a bodhisattva, and they all could be here, worrying around, and finally they lured you here in the middle of it, and then every question they ask is informing you of something, and there is a way of meditating as a teacher that all your students already know all the answers better than you do, but they're asking you the questions to get you to explain. Because you're so self-enclosed in your own egotism as a teacher that you only learn something when you tell it to yourself. So there's all kinds of, you know, if it's possible that you are unenlightened, that any of us are, and we are mistaken in some aspect of our perception, we may not be able to see the bodhisattvas around us. So it might be a good yoga to perceive others as bodhisattvas. And try to learn from them, and everyone can be our teacher in that way. There are all kinds of ways of thinking about it like that. But, you know, I totally sympathize with you. I once had a dream, and this is the last thing, quickly. In 1971, when I was in El Mora, nearby where Bhim Karoli Baba lives, Ramdas was actually there, and a lot of people in those days. He was in a little different town. And in this dream, and this was during a time of the Bangladesh genocide by the West Pakistanis of the Bengalis, whether they were Hindus or Muslims, they didn't care. They were killing all the Bengalis they could. And in the Indian press, you got news of that in this place we were. And we didn't have phones, iPhones, and things at that time, but it was just really terrible. So I had this dream, and my root teacher was sitting on the stone bench with this Himalayan backdrop outside the house that I was living in the dream. And I was railing at him angrily. And I was saying, where's the Nirmanakaya? Where's this? There's a verse, like, you know, I make offering to Avalokiteshvara, that's the Bodhisattva of the universal compassion of all Buddhas, who has the thousand eyes of the thousand Buddhas of this golden era, and the thousand arms of the thousand wheel-turning monarchs, you know, which are positive kings, you know, positive leaders of this era, and who can manifest whatsoever is needed by whomsoever to help them out of universal compassion. You know, there's a verse like that. So I was saying, what is this crap? Where are these people? How can this atrocities be going on down the Himalayan wall there, down in West Bengal, in Bengal? And he said, he looked very serious, very, you know, concerned, with a kind of grim look on his face. But he didn't say anything. And then he just got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And pretty soon he was blotting out the 26,000, 27,000 foot snow peaks in the wonderful vision, you know, view of this particular Indian hill station. And I was shouting still, though, impatiently, angrily, like a little flea way down underneath his knee type of thing. And it just, it was just bigger and bigger. And that's when I fell in love with Ram Dass, actually, who I used to know as Richard Alpert, which was not quite as lovable. But he was still very nice. He was still very nice, but I knew him even from that time. But where I fell in love with him in that same period of time, he apparently spoke to, he said this in a talk he gave at Northampton and Smith much later. And he asked his guru, Neem Karoli Baba, the wonderful guru, very loving and wonderful guru. He said, Guruji, how could this horrible, what's going on, is terrible, disgusting, etc. And then the guru said to him, well, don't you see? It's all perfect. He said. And then Ram Dass said that he said back to the guru, okay, it's perfect, but it stinks. And I fell in love with him when he said that. I really thought that was great.
That's pretty great.
That is really great. Even though he respected his guru very, very much, he still was looking for the bodhisattvas, right? Okay, have a nice supper. See you later. I'll be here tonight.